Salutations. My name's Dalton Castle. Grab yourself some tacos. Hydrate. Stay limber. Because you're watching Wrestling with Regret.
You take the good, you take the bad, you take them both, and then you have Wrestling in 2019. Now, last time I counted down the worst the industry had to offer this year, but would you believe there was some good to come out of it too? This week, I'm going to rank them the top 8 best things about wrestling in 2019. Number 8, Jay White, Top Gaijin. Like Ring of Honor, New Japan Pro Wrestling found themselves in a bind when the Elite bounced, but it was Kenny Omega's departure that hurt them most of all. Thankfully, this year, New Japan just made themselves another Kenny Omega, but Kiwi. 2019 began on a high note for Switchblade Jay White. After feuding with Omega on his way out and taking over as the leader of Bullet Club, White beat Okada at Wrestle Kingdom 13, then Tanahashi the next night at New Year's Dash. 1 month later in Osaka, Jay beat Tanahashi again to become the 68th IWGP Heavyweight Champion and the youngest gaijin in history to hold the title at age 26. Though his reign lasted less than 2 months, he wasn't out of title contention for long. After a solid showing in the G1 Climax, he'd end up beating Tetsuya Naito for the Intercontinental title in September. Since then, White's made it his mission to become Switchblade 2 belts and could get his chance in the Double Gold Dash tournament at Wrestle Kingdom 14. But no matter how things end up for him on January 4th, it's clear that Jay's ascent to the top ranks in New Japan has helped ease the sting of the Elite's departure at the beginning of the year. Number 7. Jon Moxley's Freedom Tour. This year started off weird for Dean Ambrose. Soon after he turned heel in the wake of Roman Reigns' leukemia announcement, WWE took the unusual step in announcing that Dean would not be renewing his contract at the end of April. So, the hell was he gonna do in the meantime? This unprecedented move by WWE set up a whole bunch of conspiracy theories as to what it all meant. But in the end, Ambrose's time in the company ended with him being written off with a beating by Drew McIntyre, and that was that. But then on May 1st, the wrestling world learned that Jon Moxley was returning. Fans didn't have to wait long to see him as he made his AEW debut at the end of Double or Nothing in Las Vegas. Days later, he appeared on Chris Jericho's podcast and gave listeners a damning look at the inner workings of WWE Creative, speaking with the confidence and clarity of a free man with nothing to lose. If you haven't heard it yet, it's really worth a listen. And while AEW prepared for its TV debut, Moxley took his talent to New Japan where he won the IWGP US Championship and even entered a comedic partnership with Young Lion Shota Umino. Unfortunately, he'd end up being stripped of the championship after a typhoon kept him from making it to his booking. Seeing Moxley thrive in both AEW and New Japan's great to see for a lot of reasons. It appears that Moxley's in a much better mental health state than he was in WWE and is able to have more creative freedom. Not only that, it's another example of what can happen when a disgruntled wrestler bets on themselves in the open market. Number 6. Women making history. For the last few years, WWE spent a lot of time and effort in promoting their women's evolution, and though the approach has been pretty ham-fisted, it's provided for a lot of historic moments for the ladies in the company this year alone. In the first quarter of the year, we saw the return of the Women's Tag Team Championship for the first time since 1989, a floating title which allows for more women to fight for top prizes in their division. And of course, this year's WrestleMania was headlined by women for the first time ever, ending on a high note with Becky Lynch cementing her place as a top star. Though not historical per se, this year's SummerSlam saw a high-profile generational matchup between Charlotte and Trish Stratus, which more than delivered. And despite what you may think about WWE's relationship with Saudi Arabia, the fact that Lacey Evans and Natalya had the first ever women's match in that country at Crown Jewel is a major accomplishment they should be proud of. Finally, it all wrapped up at Survivor Series weekend, starting at TakeOver with the first women's War Games match, then at Survivor Series itself when the ladies main evented that show for the first time ever, and, well, the less we say about the actual match, the better. Despite the many ups and downs of how women have been booked in WWE, there's no denying the ladies have been given a lot of chances to step up this year, and for the most part, they delivered in a major way. Number 5. Roman Reigns returns from leukemia. Last year, Roman Reigns shocked audiences by announcing that his leukemia had returned and he'd be taking time off to treat it. It was one of the saddest things in wrestling that year, but I made a promise in my countdown that when he eventually came back, it would show up on the best of countdown that year, and well, here we are. Roman came back to a hero's welcome this past February and announced that his leukemia was in remission. We saw one more reunion with The Shield in a match between Roman and Drew McIntyre at WrestleMania, and since then he's been working regularly on SmackDown. After the health scare he had last year, it's great to see him back in action. Something refreshing that happened this year was the way Roman was booked upon his return. It wasn't like he was the be-all end-all, the top guy in the company anymore. Sure, he was still winning a lot of his matches, but he's not been pushed down people's throats like he was, much to the dismay of live audiences. And right now, it seems like he's being cheered a lot more than booed. WWE could have easily played up Roman's leukemia for sympathy all year long, but I think even they knew that it could have been disastrous for the company's image. With that being said, props to them for handling Roman's return to action about as well as you possibly could in 2019. As far as 2020 goes, well, we'll see how that turns out. Number 4. Kofi Mania. Yes, I've already talked at length about how his title reign ended, let's not revisit that part, but can we talk for a minute about how awesome the whole thing was in general? Mustafa Ali's untimely injury before Elimination Chamber led to a golden opportunity for Kofi Kingston, the heart and soul of the New Day, who earned the title shot after a pair of gauntlet matches between himself and his tag team partners. Though he came up just short in the Chamber match, the fans were still solidly behind Kofi in the build-up to WrestleMania. Let's be honest, WWE could have easily made this a rehash of the Triple H Booker T feud from WrestleMania 19, this thinly veiled attempt to make it about race. They came this close to doing it too, but fortunately they had some restraint, instead focusing on Kofi's 11-year run in the mid-card before getting his first real shot in the big time. And what a shot it was. One of the better matches on the night, Daniel and Kofi went at it for nearly 24 minutes before Kofi came out on top. Now, I know I said WWE didn't make it explicitly about race, but Kofi's victory was historic in that regard, as he became the first black man since The Rock to hold the championship, which was very important to a lot of people. Representation's very important in pro wrestling, and if you don't believe me, look at this footage of MVP and Shad from Crime Time as they reacted to Kofi's victory. That says it all right there. Number 3. The Fiend. After WrestleMania, fans began seeing creepy vignettes with a vulture puppet popping out of a box or a witch doll laughing. You could tell it had something to do with Bray Wyatt, but fans had no idea what they were in for. Not for long, at least. We soon saw a new, seemingly reformed Bray Wyatt as the host of his own kids' show, The Firefly Funhouse, where he'd slowly begin to weave his own brand of terror in with the comedy. It fast became the highlight of weekly programming. Before long, Bray used the show to debut The Fiend, a horrifying personification of his evil side, with a new look that revolved around his now iconic mask designed by horror icon Tom Savini. After months of building momentum and intrigue, The Fiend finally debuted in person at SummerSlam nearly 5 months after those creepy vignettes first aired. From his entrance to his dominant performance against Finn Balor, Wyatt had the entire wrestling fandom in the palm of his hand. It was a tour de force, a mesmerizing performance that fans couldn't look away from. Despite some questionable booking since his debut, Hell in a Cell, The Fiend remains one of the most captivating characters in the entire company, with many of his details still shrouded in mystery as he sits on top on SmackDown as the Universal Champion. As far as character reinventions go, at least in the short term, this has to rank right up there with the all-time best. Number 2. AEW and the Wednesday Night War. 1 year ago, on the day of this video's release, All Elite Wrestling was officially born to great fanfare. Based on the success of All In the previous year, coupled with the backing of the Khan family, the Elite appeared to have lightning in a bottle, and many fans were excited to see somebody step up to the big McMahon family empire. As the months went on, AEW would officially debut with Double or Nothing in May, followed by Fyter Fest and Fight for the Fallen over the summer. Not every show was perfect, but there were plenty of big moments and matches that kept people talking as this new company ironed out some of their kinks. When it was announced that AEW would make Wednesday nights on TNT their home, WWE responded by moving NXT to the USA Network. No longer a network exclusive, the show is now broadcast to a wider audience, and has officially been promoted from a developmental league to its own separate brand from Raw and SmackDown. By forcing WWE's hand, AEW's made Wednesday nights very interesting. Now, there have always been alternatives in wrestling, always other options out there. But for the first time since Impact tried it in 2010, someone's finally stepping up to compete directly with the Big Bad, and it's giving the company a run for their money. And with a big budget and a flashy presentation right out the gate, AEW's made it clear they're not just some fly-by-night promotion, they're in it for the long haul. Whether you think NXT is better than AEW or vice versa doesn't really matter. The important thing is both these shows are giving you their best effort. No one's phoning it in, no one's being lazy, they're doing the best they possibly can to keep your eyeballs fixed on the product. Blind tribalism on social media aside, I believe this competition can be good for all of wrestling, and here's why. My pick for the number one best thing about wrestling in 2019 is the Great Wrestling Arms Race. When AEW began to form at the beginning of the year, things got serious. As they've often done throughout history, WWE responded by scooping up as much independent talent from all around the world as they possibly could. Not for any altruistic reasons, mind you, but just to make sure that they had them and no one else did. But the side effect of that is, with all the fighting and the stockpiling between WWE and AEW, suddenly the floodgates have opened and other major companies are following suit, signing whoever they can to stay competitive and unique. Outside of the big two feds, in the last several months, Impact, Ring of Honor, and MLW have also been signing hot wrestlers to contracts and getting better TV deals. But it's so much more than those companies. The NWA is running a weekly studio show on YouTube, New Japan's announced an official expansion into the US, even Women of Wrestling's made a comeback and is gaining an audience. The old saying goes, competition can be good for wrestling, but that goes so much farther beyond just WWE and AEW. Competition comes in all shapes and sizes. So many more options are out there today competing for your eyeballs on their product, which means more opportunities for wrestlers. These companies are being forced to invest in their talent, which is leading to a great time in wrestling. Before recently, it seemed it was harder to make a name for yourself in professional wrestling, but thanks to the changing landscape and the proliferation of social media, so many wrestlers who were on the bubble for years or being ignored are finally getting their chance to shine. More wrestlers are being given the chance to wrestle for a living, improving their stock and exposing themselves to a whole new crop of fans, which can only be a good thing. And that's why I say the Great Wrestling Arms Race is the best thing to happen in the year 2019. What other great moments in the year do you think belong on this countdown? Let me know in the comment section below. Happy New Year, everyone. I'm Brian Zane, and this is 2020.